A wild high-speed chase during rush hour traffic here in Oklahoma City.
You saw it come to an end just about 35 minutes ago, live right here on News Channel 4.
Bob Moore, Chopper 4 pilot, reporter John Welsh showed us the dramatic conclusion. The driver of this red car ended up with nowhere to go. Take a look at this, a dead end. He suddenly threw the car into reverse, backed up toward the officers who were chasing him, and then suddenly hit the gas again and crashed right into a large fence. At first, it appeared as though he were going to give up, but as you see, he had a change of heart and decided to take off. He ran across a grassy area and then made his way into a parking lot. That's where it looked like a bystander confronted him and ended up helping officers take him into custody. And at this hour, we're still waiting to hear official word from police on what sparked the chase. We'll continue to keep you updated. Breaking tonight, the dangerous discovery officers found in the man's car. News Channel 4's Leslie Rangel is live, and Leslie, it's dangerous enough they had to call the bomb squad in, right? Tell us what they found.
That's right, Kevin, and the bomb squad left actually just moments ago, and OKC police was able to confirm that a grenade found in the car was not live. It had been hollowed out. Now, late tonight, police released the name of the people, two people who actually led police on the high-speed chase. Bob Moore, Chopper 4, was over the chase within minutes. Police trying to pull over a driver. Tonight, we know her name is Maria Moore.
The pursuit wound through several city streets. Somewhere on Pennsylvania, the vehicle pulled to a stop, and the female driver exited and ran from the vehicle.
From there, a man got behind the wheel and kept going, with police and Chopper 4 hot on his tail until he literally ran out of road.
Pursuing here into Mustang, where the vehicle crashed through a fence, coming just short of a military facility, Armed Forces Reserve facility, here on 400 block of Cedar Springs.
But the drama didn't end there. The driver was not giving up.
The male driver then fled from the vehicle on foot and was tackled by two military members from this facility. And then by officers.
Video from Bob Moore, Chopper 4, shows what looks like an officer running towards the suspect from the bottom right of your screen. He goes in between two trucks, jumps on the suspect, and begins punching him.
I can't comment on any of that. I'm not sure what happened there, so any use of force that might have occurred will be investigated.
Tonight, police say that wanted man is Wayne Calbaugh, a wanted felon who's now accused of running from police and having a gun. Now, right now is a wrecker. You can barely see it. We were asked to move about 300 meters back because of that bomb threat. That wrecker is, again, taking that car away to be impounded. Of course, stay with us online as this story continues to develop. Reporting live in Mustang, Leslie Rangel, News Channel 4.
Thank you, Leslie. And from the Sky Center tonight.
You're watching News Channel 4 at 10, the news leader.
And we begin tonight at 10 with a story you'll see only on News Channel 4.
It is critical new information about the arrest of Pearl Pearson. Pearson is 64 years old and deaf, and he was seriously injured, as you can tell, by highway patrol troopers during a routine traffic stop.
Our coverage of that violent arrest sparked a criminal investigation into the officer's actions. News Channel 4's Allie Meyer has been talking with a number of people involved in the incident.
And tonight, she's the only Oklahoma reporter who has obtained the dash cam video from that traffic stop and the breaking new details on the criminal investigation surrounding this case.
For months, we've been telling you about the trooper loophole, a special exemption in the Oklahoma Open Records Act that means OHP doesn't have to release dash cam video. And so in the arrest of Pearl Pearson and so many others throughout our state, OHP refused to release the tape. But now that the Pearl Pearson arrest is part of a criminal case, we got the tape. Take a look.
It's 10:30 at night and Trooper Eric Foster is on patrol. He's in the driver's seat. He's got a civilian ride along next to him, and we're going to hide that man's identity. They are catching up to the suspect in a hit and run. The victims, with their flashers on, following behind the suspect SUV, Pearl Pearson is in the driver's seat of that white Suburban. The whole thing started at 19th Street and Moore, where Pearson allegedly backed into a vehicle with three people inside. The driver called 911 and tailed Pearson until OHP caught up at I-40 and Eastern.
When you look at the dash cam tape, do you see a textbook arrest or do you see officer abuse?
I see a great deal of restraint.
Hand up window! Hand up window! Hand up
window. Both guys out the window.
They had enough sense about them and showed enough restraint to where they did what they thought they needed to do and nothing more. So I don't see textbook. Yeah.
Support staff. DA David Prater has analyzed the dash cam video to look for evidence of police brutality.
Both guys out the window. Do it now.
What he found instead, he calls a textbook case of police restraint. You see, troopers feared Pearson had a weapon.
They're like, put your hands out of the vehicle, show us your hands. And they're not just yelling it, they're all going like this. And then right about there is where he reaches down. Right when they're right next to the vehicle, he reaches down very quickly.
The camera rolls for the entire ordeal, most of the action off screen. But even though you can't see the arrest, you can hear it. For 5.5 minutes, you hear officers struggle with Pearl Pearson. They have no idea he is profoundly deaf, and they have no idea why he's resisting.
Incredibly helpful. I wish that every law enforcement agency had dash cam, because it tells the rest of the story. No matter what the story is, it tells the truth, and that's why it's very important. And I relied on it greatly in this case in determining what to do.
OHP detectives interviewed 5 troopers, that civilian ride along, and the 3 people in the car Pearson backed into. They all say the same thing. Pearson fought the officers when they tried to make the arrest. Documents show when Pearson reached down for his hearing impaired placard, officers believed he was reaching for a gun.
You have to comply with law enforcement, and they have to see your hands. Your hands can kill someone. That's what you grab weapons with. That's what you punch people with. That's what you stab people with. That's what you shoot people with. Your hands.
When the cuffs are finally on and Pearson is finally in police custody, his face bears the marks of that scuffle. His eyes swollen shut. Hospital records indicate his shoulder had been dislocated. Also on the dash cam tape, those moments after the arrest, where troopers finally learn Pearl Pearson is hearing impaired.
It said hearing impaired on the thing.
It said hearing impaired.
Like deaf.
Well,
it doesn't matter. When we're trying to get his hands, he's still fighting. Dude was strong, man.
I believe he came close to his death that night.
Pearl Pearson's defense attorney, Billy Coyle, hasn't seen the video yet, but he stands with his client and believes Pearson was roughed up unnecessarily by the OHP.
A minor accident that the officers didn't witness. They didn't need to draw guns on Mr. Pearson that night. They didn't need to yank him out of the car and beat him like some animal. They savagely beat this man for no reason.
Coyle is shocked his deaf client is now facing a criminal charge for resisting arrest.
Very disappointed that the district attorney thinks that my client resisted arrest. He didn't resist arrest. He was trying to get his hands in front of them to let them know that he was deaf. I can't speak.
Those that advocate for the disabled, you know, I understand that, but you also need to understand the other side of it. Mr. Pearson's very fortunate to be alive today, and that's because of his actions.
DA David Prater has cleared the highway patrolman of all wrongdoing. He sent word to the OHP this afternoon. Allie Meyer, News Channel 4.
If you'd like to see more or hear more about the arrest of Pearl Pearson, log on to KFOR.com. That's where we've posted the video of the entire arrest.
Gary's Chicaro is a restaurant and bar in Enid. It's been open for more than 4 decades and carries quite the reputation.
I've been in business 44 years. I think I can spot a freak or I really don't want gays around. I don't deal with these people walking down the street with no jobs, welfare. If I reached over there and slapped the out of you, you should be offended. But to say chink, you know, or somebody calling me a bigot, that doesn't bother me. Why should it bother you?
Would you call me chink?
No. Not unless we were drinking and joking around or something.
That's the owner, Gary James. Now a wave of comments sweeping Facebook claim he refuses to serve blacks, Hispanics, and people with disabilities like Matt Gard.
He just doesn't like certain people of race, of color, ethnicity.
Gard was a regular at Gary's Chicaro's for years. He turned a blind eye to the owner's choice of customers until recently.
Now he tried to find a weak excuse to not let me in as with my wheelchair, or the weak excuse of having loud people with me.
After getting turned away for a steak dinner, Guard says it's about his disability.
He created the issue.
James claims that's not the case.
You only have one time here. You create more an issue, you're out forever.
Guard and at least 140 others on this Facebook page say James has crossed the line to discrimination. Even the business's t-shirt is offensive. Derogatory slogans against homosexuals splashed on both sides. It has the N-word on the front and check out the sleeve, offensive to women, and threats of violence against Muslims, minorities, and Democrats. James proudly wears the shirt.
I really don't want gays around. Any man that would compromise his body would compromise anything.
Loud behavior that doesn't sit well with everyone.
The people that still go back and patronize his business are condoning his behavior and how he treats other people.
Well, if you work, you own a business, you pay your taxes, you're more than welcome in here. If you're on welfare, stay at home. Spend my money there.
Strong words in a small town where so far no one has challenged his business practices. In Enid, Ashley Kringen, News Channel 4.
This is undercover video from inside an illegal gathering. You're inside a cockfight banned for years now. Roosters armed with spurs fighting, in many cases, to the death.
Come on, I made it.
It's activity which is illegal in all 50 states, though this Oklahoma rancher says his livestock, his livelihood, gamecocks.
You got every color imaginable.
This chicken ranch in rural Oklahoma is not hidden, despite the fact the sport these birds are raised for is illegal. And that is what brought us here.
This is about my constitutional rights.
B.L. Kozad says the state's ban on cockfighting is preventing him from harvesting his livestock and making a living.
And the method of harvest of a gamecock is competing it against another gamecock.
He believes the state law banning cockfighting violates his religious rights in that God has given man dominion over the animals. He says the ban also puts his family in danger.
This law creates situations where government agents will make raids and rip our families apart and point guns at us.
Okay.
Kozad says raids in the past prove the agencies who enforce the law are willing to risk a human life to keep these chickens from fighting. He's willing to do whatever it takes to protect his family.
Every time law enforcement officers make a raid, they create situations where they're going to potentially hurt, cripple, or kill a human being.
Here they come. Law enforcement, whoever they were, carrying big guns and a running. They looked like a platoon in attack coming across.
Hayden Heiss is 88 years old, a lifelong fan of the sport. He was arrested in a raid a few years ago.
One run up behind me and grabbed me and slammed me into the wall.
Stuck the assault rifles in my face, three of them.
Don Gray was at the same raid. He says there were SWAT teams with rifles, helicopters, and state police.
They treated us, I think, like we were murderers or rapists or whatever, you know, or just for fighting a rooster.
And the Constitution is written to protect human rights, not animals. Can you pass the same exact law against a cattleman that you passed against a gamecock farmer?
Kozad says these birds are not trained fighters. He believes they fight because it's in their genes.
You can't force it to fight. You can't train it to fight. You can't make it fight. It fights because of the natural instincts that God put into the creature.
While he knows law enforcement, the government, and animal rights agencies will continue to battle against cockfighting, he says the sport will not disappear.
You're never going to stop the gamecock farmers from harvesting their gamecocks without killing the gamecock farmer.
Shelley Mills, News Channel 4.
I ain't had no money, so this is what I had to do.
With our cameras in his face and Bob Moore Chopper 4 overhead, Michael Patton admits to breaking the law.
I messed up, but remember this. I take care of my kids no matter what.
Yo! Whoa, whoa.
Police say Patton stole, then crashed this cab, while officers used GPS to track the speeding van's location.
Just going through kind of a heavy wooded area.
But when the alleged cabbie carjacker, wearing a blonde wig, ditched the cab and tried to escape on foot, Bob Moore Chopper 4 led police right to him.
With the helicopter flying over, we were able to track down and locate the suspect.
After police cuffed the confessed crook, Patton explained he needed money because he has 11 kids and another on the way.
I confess to my sins, and I'm going to do my time. I got a social degree. I could be one of them. I was going to school to be a cop. But I lost my mind over these kids.
Luckily, while the cab got damaged during the chase, the cab driver escaped without major injury.
He stabbed me. He wanted to try to kill me. And he said, get out the cab. I get out.
I stole a necklace from Pierce Square Mall.
Sitting in the squad car, Patton confessed to other recent thefts and before being taken to jail, offered some advice to the city's youth.
If kids is watching this, y'all get this through y'all's heads. Don't do no crime, or you will do the time.
How shocked were you to find this notice on your door?
I was real shocked. Very shocked.
Ramona Hudson served with this ultimatum from city inspectors.
They said, I need all of that removed all the way back to the fence back there.
The dilapidated buildings and debris are a major fire hazard. Ramona, a widow, wants it gone too, but doesn't have the cash to pay someone to remove it. The city has given her two more weeks to figure things out.
And if you don't take care of it?
They will. And then they'll put a lien on your property. This is my home. I'm 84 years old. And this is all I have.
So we got busy on the phone. Not even 5 minutes later, we hit the jackpot.
Why not? I mean, she needs help, and we're all about helping people.
Kevin Cates and Midwest Wrecking will handle all of the removal at no cost to Ramona.
So you guys are going to take this down too?
Yeah, we'll take both these down.
Sweet.
Changing the world one simple act at a time.
Excited to get this done once and for all?
I mean, I really am. Thank you so much.
No problem. We're excited to get it done for you, too.
All right. Well, thank you. Lord's going to bless you.
Right now, we're working with the utility companies and the city to secure a demolition permit. Once we get one, Midwest Wrecking will get the green light to finally get to work. We should have all this debris gone by the end of the month. We'll keep you posted. I'm Scott Hines, in your corner.
This is my home. I'm 84 years old, and this is all I have.
The last time we caught up with Ramona Hudson, the city was threatening to file a lien against her property because of these dilapidated buildings and debris.
They said, I need all of that removed all the way back to the fence back there.
Our hearts went out to the senior. The last survivor in her family, she turned to us because she didn't have the cash or resources to get the job done on her own. We knew exactly who to call. Kevin Cates and Midwest Wrecking offered up their crew and heavy equipment free of charge.
Got the permit this morning and got started on it, and we're ready to go.
It's amazing. I didn't know that great big truck was going to get up in there, though.
They had two big trucks up
in
there.
Oh, okay.
Ramona tickled pink.
Yeah, so this is a joy, I'm telling you. Okay.
She can't believe her eyes.
The house is gone.
The house is gone. How crazy is that?
Oh my goodness.
It came down fast.
Yeah, when I was out here before, it was still here. And now it's gone.
Midwest Wrecking demonstrating the change it wants to see in the world.
I just want to say thank you, and I know the Lord is going to bless them. Because anytime they have all of this equipment to do this, it's costing them money.
A job well done.
So I am just so thankful to you, Scott, really, and Channel 4, really. This is really a blessing.
I'm Scott Hines, in your corner.
This thing is on the ground, grinding, ripping everything up.
491, where's your emergency?
Yes, this is Glenn Lewis. Mayor, run those sirens one more time. It is huge.
An image that still spawns nightmares.
Tornado emergency now in effect for more. Tornado emergency for more. You folks in more, you need to grab whatever it is you need to grab, and you need to go underground.
This thing is sucking us in, and we're a mile away.
We had to bail out of it because it was coming right at us. It's absolutely massive.
Studies will later show close to half of the people in the damage path are in underground shelters at this moment. You're inside one of those shelters as the tornado hits. The twister has sucked out the air vents, giving a direct view into the storm.
Oh my God, are you serious?
Curiosity replaces fear. The first look at how their neighborhood has changed.
It's gone.
Jerry Gravett was among those in that cellar.
And whenever I come up out of that cellar, I figured that there was going to be not only hundreds, but possibly maybe thousands of people that perished. I mean, it was that bad.
This is Jerry Street, just the day before the tornado. This is the street after it was reshaped by EF5 winds, believed to be in excess of 220 miles an hour.
A tornado like that, if you ain't below ground, there's a good chance you might not make it.
Jerry's neighbor, Deanna Ward, the retired RN's home was across the street. She and her son, Mark, lost their television coverage and lost track of the storm until it was on them. There was no time to get to the neighbor's shelter.
Me and Mom, we were sitting down in a closet and with a pillow on her head, holding hands, and bricks started hitting the house. Mom said, we're not going to make it. And I said, oh yeah, we are.
As Mark watched helplessly, the tornado began lifting the entire house.
You know, I was sitting on the carpet. I could see that the other room was up about 15 foot high. And the walls, the roof, the windows, it was all in one piece. It just took it up and flung like that in like 2 seconds.
Seconds that changed everything.
Everything was just gone and different. The guy across the street had the immaculate yard. Well, there wasn't no yard. And the guy next door that had the red Corvette that he wiped with a diaper every once a week, it was all smashed up in a ball, and Mom was gone. She was slumped over.
Deanna Ward, hit by debris, was one of the storm's 24 fatalities. Mark is back working as a painter, recovering from a 2x4 that impaled his arm and debris that crushed bones in his hand. He has a plate in his shoulder that was broken in two places.
And I just felt blessed to have made it.
As spring comes to Moore again, there are signs of resiliency. While the scars of the storm are still visible, evidence of rebirth and renewal. Yet amid the sounds of rebuilding, a question. How did a storm this violent, an EF5 with winds in excess of 220 miles an hour, a tornado that moved through dense residential neighborhoods, hit a hospital, two schools, and shopping center, how did it claim only 24 of those we love when it could have taken hundreds? Preliminary studies in Moore say 98% of those who responded knew the tornado was coming and took protective action. Many left. 75% were watching television for live, immediate, street-by-street coverage of the storm's progress and were prepared. Many gathered in cellars and safe rooms. But the unsettling statistic: of the 24 we lost, and even one is too many, 73% died sheltering in place, victims who sought shelter in interior closets, hallways, or bathrooms.
Those are safe places until you start talking about F5 tornadoes, because they, as we have seen time and time again, have the ability to sweep the foundation clean. You can't wait till it's bearing down on your street. You are truly taking your life into your own hands.
911 tapes from that day reflect the panic of those unprepared.
Okay, I need you guys to get inside and take cover.
There's nowhere to go, dog.
I'm on Santa Fe and Cross Street. Where is the tornado at?
Last we heard was 19th and Western.
Oh my God.
Okay, if you're able to take shelter, you need to.
Where can we go for shelter?
I need to know where the designated Moore.
The city of Moore has no public shelter, ma'am. You need to be in shelter now.
Jerry Gravett is rebuilding on the lot he's called home for 25 years. But he's adding something he's never had.
I'm still going to have a cellar put in. And everybody up and down through here that all moved back, every one of them's had no cellar put in.
You need to be in shelter now.
It is the ultimate life insurance in a state that has spawned the most violent winds on the planet.
Imagine a world without laughter, without music,
without ever hearing a single bedtime story. Silence is a real prison for thousands of hearing impaired in the Republic of Congo.
He came back from the movies crying because he couldn't hear.
I couldn't hear. That's it. So then, really, I suffered myself within my heart.
It is often a life of prejudice, ridicule, and segregation.
When you're separated by hearing, you're separated from the nourishment our spirit needs to hear those words that I love you and talk about the future and have hope for the future.
Hope arrives this day in the form of a 6'10", 235-pound power forward. Serge Ibaka is teaming up with Starkey Hearing Foundation and Pros for Africa to help all of these people, every one of them, experience and explore the world of sound.
He's living with a purpose, and he knows that he's got this incredible platform with the NBA, with the Oklahoma City Thunder.
The Oklahoma City Thunder star will help fit hundreds with free hearing aids.
Make those kids smile, make them happy. For me, it's the most important than just to be here for a superstar.
These folks are getting more than just hearing aids. They're being freed from a life of isolation. In fact, one man came here just 2 days after his wife died. He wanted to be able to hear at her funeral.
Adults and children alike, for many, our voices are the very first thing they will ever hear.
Yeah, see? That's good.
Can you say, number one? Number one. Bah, bah, bah.
That's amazing, isn't it?
It's amazing, man.
From living a life of solitude to one of hope and opportunity.
It's a good day.
Yeah, it's a good day. It's a very good day.
Lives forever changed, thanks in part to a giant with gentle hands and a tender heart. In the Republic of Congo, Lance West, News Channel 4.
What started as a simple conversation during a game between Oklahoma City Police Sergeant Sean Byrne and Josette Nelson, the wife of Barons head coach Todd Nelson, sparked a program that's unlike any other in professional sports.
At the time, she was working with children with intellectual disabilities at a local high school, and she was wanting to integrate some type of a program with the players and the children with intellectual disabilities and adults. And the Barons Buddies concept came up.
The four-year-old concept allows Barons players to adopt Special Olympians for the season.
Take a selfie.
A selfie?
Yeah.
Okay.
Each player hosts their buddy for four events. On this particular evening, the athletes had the opportunity to play games, hang out on the ice, and tour the locker room with their Barons player.
This is for you, Sarah. That's your own hockey stick.
Cool, huh?
You say thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah.
Just seeing her excited about stuff makes me excited. So, and that they involved our family, not just her, but all of us have got to do stuff.
While the Barons live on the ice, some, like John Rinchen, had their very first experience in a rink, which was a moment he won't soon forget.
I just never thought I would be able to go on this stuff because it's like a privilege doing this. And it feels like I shouldn't have the privilege, but yet I'm on it right now. I feel like the king of the world right now.
It's one of the greatest parts about playing hockey and getting to do it for a living is that you get to share these experiences with other people. And, you know, for me, it's a great time, and I hope John had just as much fun.
It's perfect.
The bond formed between the Barons and their buddies runs much deeper than the events they attend together during the season. In many cases, the players tend to become members of the families that they're partnered with.
At the end of the year, I was recovery and I was in the hospital or whatever, and Isaiah and their family came to visit me, and it put a smile on my face. And this year, when I got back to Oklahoma City, one of the first things I did was go to one of his t-ball games, and that was really special to us. I got so attached to Isaiah, and everything he thought of was hockey, was Matt, and they think it's for those kids, but it's something special for us.
In a violent sport that's encased in a frozen world, these athletes bring a warmth no one can deny.
Let it go, let it go, can't hold it back anymore.
Proof that some people really are worth melting for.
Bye, I love you.
In Oklahoma City, Dylan Buckingham, News Channel 4 Sports.
Well, what better way to break up the week than with a pay it forward story that I promise will stick with you for sure. Tonight, our recipient is someone who champions children every day and then goes above and beyond. News Channel 4's Meg Alexander introduces us to a man who is so much more than a coach.
At Monroney Middle School, it's pretty common to see these two tooling around.
To do this, troubleshoot.
From fixing sixth grader Kyle Bratcher's wheelchair to coaching the middle school wrestling team, Coach Keith Richards has it all covered. But he really has Kyle covered.
We'd do anything for this guy.
Kyle was born a thriving baby.
Since he was little, he's always been very athletically inclined until he had his brain tumor.
The tumor changed everything.
He had a brain tumor when he was three, and they told us that he wouldn't survive and he wasn't going to do well.
But Kyle bucked that and he beat the brain tumor. It may have affected a number of things, but inside, this 12-year-old is ready to go. And one of the things he always wanted to do was wrestle. So Coach Keith made that happen.
And then I got to end up wrestling on the mat.
We have a special wrestler out here today. His name is Kyle the Hammer Bratcher.
With the crowd cheering, Kyle the Hammer rose to the challenge.
He can tell you how the match went. He'll tell you right now, he busted out the cradle and rolled the guy over and he had no idea what was going on.
A wrestling match that for most kids like Kyle would never have happened, except on Coach Keith's watch.
You did wrestling, Coach.
Which is why Coach Keith was nominated for Pay It Forward.
He really cares for the kids. Not just to be successful outside the classroom, but also inside.
Michael, I want to introduce you to Amy Troutman from Spirit Bank, and she has something for you.
Hi, Michael.
Hi.
It's great to meet you.
You too.
It sounds like everything that Coach Keith does is above and beyond, so I would appreciate if you would take this $400 to pay it forward to Coach Keith. 100, 200, 300, 400.
What he did for Kyle left a smile on Kyle's face that I'm always going to remember.
I'm Meg Alexander from Channel 4. So nice to meet you. We have a program called Pay It Forward that we do with Spirit Bank. And Michael has a little something for you.
Hi, Coach Keith. On behalf of Spirit Bank, Channel 4, myself and others, I have some money to hand you for just being an awesome person to Kyle, other students, and inspiring them. Here's $400 for you.
He changed my life.
What makes you go?
Just love and desire and passion, guys. Sports unify people, and they give people an outlet.
And for Kyle, it gave him the chance to do what so many take for granted.
If I could take that kind of fire and put it in my athletes, we have to think outside the box, and to make these kind of experiences happen. For not only Kyle, just for any student. He changed my life.
And you, Coach Keith, have changed his. Meg Alexander, News Channel 4.
Oh, that was awesome.
Fabulous. Now, if you know of someone who deserves to be recognized through our Pay It Forward program, we'd sure like to hear about it.
She was 10 when her father let her take the wheel of a wheat combine for the first time.
It's one of my favorite places to be.
Brittany Crable didn't cut very straight, but she had a patient teacher.
I rode with my grandpa and my dad, and they let me slowly take over, and I would cut something really crazy, and then they'd go back and clean it up and keep going.
Jeff Crable was a fourth-generation farmer. Brittany, the daughter, who took her first tractor ride before she could even walk. By the age of 13, she was driving this enormous machine herself. She had to. In 2009, Jeff was diagnosed with brain cancer.
It scared me because I didn't know what was going to happen, but he sat me down and said, we're a family. We've got God. We'll get through it.
He died 2 years later.
There's still a hole in the home and a hole in our hearts.
Another June, another harvest, The first test cut reveals what nature gave them this spring. Just enough moisture for a crop, too much right now to cut the rest.
Little wet, the kernels, they don't appear to be too shriveled, so looks pretty good.
Over five generations, people like Wayne Crable learned from his father. He taught his son, who taught his daughter. Jeff might not be here physically, but his legacy is all around.
Start from nothing and can accumulate a few things. It's good that you can pass it on. Someone maybe can benefit from what you put together.
Grandpa Wayne, Brittany, and Mom Karen wait patiently for the fields to dry so they can cut wheat, just as they waited patiently for the rains to come. As we sit and talk, the clouds pass over Crown Mound. The subject of legacy turns on the axis of the faith that gets us through good years and bad.
That hope of heaven, that eternal hope, is what carries us through the struggles of today.
She graduated from high school this spring, nearly 3 years now since her father passed away. After the first cut of the season, Brittany gathers up a little bundle and brings it to where he rests.
I would just cut a little bit off with my pocket knife and bring it out here.
A father's legacy passes on.
Just kind of my own reminder of a little bit of why I do what I do. It's something my family's loved for a lot of years.
Near Hydro, Galen Culver, News Channel 4. Is this a great state or what?
You're watching News Channel 4 at 10, the news leader.
Tonight, an execution at McAllister goes terribly wrong. This inmate strapped to the table. The lethal cocktail started when it happens, an end no one saw coming.
And that is where we begin tonight at 10 with breaking news from the state prison in McAllister.
The first of two scheduled executions at the prison did not go as planned. Now, the news is making news around the world tonight. Even Al Jazeera is reporting on it.
Clayton Lockett was supposed to receive the death penalty for killing a woman 15 years ago. But tonight, his punishment is being referred to as a botched execution.
We begin our team coverage tonight in McAllister with News Channel 4's Ed Doney and Courtney Francisco. And Ed, you were outside the prison this evening at 6 o'clock when all of this was going on. And Courtney, you were one of the ones inside witnessing the execution.
Linda, that's right, and we kept watching officials look at their watches, wondering when they were going to get the phone call to tell us the time of death for Clayton Lockett. And Courtney was inside witnessing all of this. You have an unbelievable story to tell, and we'll get to that in just a minute. But first, to give you an idea of how bizarre this was, we're told in the last 19 executions, the average time it took an inmate to actually die is 6 to 12 minutes. This took at least four times as long, and the end result was the last thing anyone expected. Death row inmate Charles Warner will live for at least 14 more days. He was supposed to be executed at 8 p.m. Tuesday night in McAllister, but the botched execution of Clayton Lockett forced officials to postpone Warner's.
I notified the Attorney General's office, the Governor's office, of my intent to stop the execution.
DOC Director Robert Patton said Lockett received his first injection at 6:23 p.m. However, Lockett maintained some consciousness, and witnesses say he began slowly convulsing. Minutes later, a doctor in the room decided to stop the execution after a vein had ruptured in Lockett, according to Patton. And at 7:06 p.m., 43 minutes after his first injection, Lockett suffered a heart attack and died inside the execution room.
That is it. That is all my statement. That is all the information I have at this time.
This was a horrible thing to witness. One of the things he said was something's wrong. He said man at one point. He kept trying to raise up.
David Autry is one of Lockett's attorneys. He had argued the state's secrecy law regarding the lethal injection drugs violated his client's Eighth Amendment rights, protecting against a cruel and unusual punishment. Now he says Tuesday's disaster proves the state rushed into this execution with an unproven mix of drugs.
They wanted to hurry up and get it done with as little transparency as possible. This is what they get. There should not be another execution in this state until there's a full investigation into what went wrong.
Autry says this is the definition of cruel and unusual. Supposedly, that is what is protected against in the Eighth Amendment. Those three drugs were supposed to cause unconsciousness, stop breathing, and stop Lockett's heart. And joining me now, Courtney Francisco, one of the few people inside witnessing tonight's execution. And Courtney, it was almost like you were walking through the set of a movie. As you're walking down the hallway, the inmates were banging on the cell doors, showing support for Lockett. Is that right?
That's right, Ed. And admittedly, this is the first time I've witnessed an execution. But before I went in there, prison officials explained to me that normally lethal injections take 6 to 12 minutes, that inmates basically fall asleep. They did note that in this case, it could take a little longer because of the new execution drugs the state was using, but after watching Lockett's execution for about 16 minutes, it was clear something was not right. He was struggling to get up, to talk, to move around, and I did document the process. Take a look at my eyewitness notes. 6:23, prison officials raise the blinds. Execution begins. 6:28, inmate shivering, sheet shaking. He's breathing deep. 6:29, inmate blinking and gritting his teeth, adjusts his head. 6:30, prison officials check to see if inmate is unconscious. Doctor says he's not unconscious. Inmate says, I'm not. Female prison official says, Mr. Lockett is not unconscious. 6:32, inmate's breathing is normal, mouth open, eyes shut. For a second time, prison officials check to see if inmate is unconscious. 6:33, doctor says he is unconscious. Prison official says Mr. Lockett is unconscious. 6:34, inmate's mouth twitches, no sign of breathing. 6:35, mouth movement. 6:36, inmate's head moves from side to side, then he lifts his head off the bed. 6:37, inmate lifts his head and feet slightly off the bed. Inmate tries to say something, mumbles while moving his body. 6:38, more movement by the inmate. At this point, the inmate is breathing heavily and appears to be struggling. 6:39, inmate struggles to talk, says man, and appears to be trying to get up. Doctor checks on inmate. Female prison official says, we are going to lower the blinds temporarily. Prison phone rings. Director of Prisons, Robert Patton, answers the phone and leaves the room, taking three state officials with him. Minutes later, the director of prisons comes back into the room and tells the eyewitnesses that there's been a vein failure. He says the chemical did not make it into the vein of the prisoner. Under my authority, we are issuing a stay of execution. And let's not forget the victim in this case, Stephanie Neiman. Her family witnessed the execution behind us, and they sent us this letter. It says, God blessed us with our precious daughter, Stephanie, for 19 years. Stephanie loved children. She worked in Vacation Bible School and always helped with our church nativity scenes. She was the joy of our life, Susie and Steve Neiman. Ed.
Courtney, thanks. And when I was in the media room across the street, you could just see how shaken up everybody was when they witnessed that. I can only imagine how disturbing that was for you as well.
Well, everyone in there was quite unsettled by this because once the blinds went down, Ed, we had no clue of what was going on the other side of those blinds. No clue of what was happening to the inmate at that point. Later, they let us out of that room and we found out that it took him until 7:05 to actually die of a massive heart attack behind those blinds.
And the Department of Corrections were not releasing any more details other than that. We will, of course, follow up with this tomorrow. One other note, David Autry, the attorney for Lockett, who we interviewed earlier tonight, he said that Lockett's family was not here. Warner's was, and he does not know at this point if Lockett's family will decide to file a lawsuit against the Oklahoma Department of Corrections for the unbelievable events that happened here tonight in McAllister. For Courtney Francisco, I'm Ed Doney, News Channel 4.
All right, thank you, team. Good job down there. About an hour and 20 minutes after Lockett's fatal heart attack, the governor's office released a statement.
And in it, Governor Mary Fallon mentioned the 14-day stay for the next scheduled execution. And she also said, quote, I've asked the Department of Corrections to conduct a full review of Oklahoma's execution procedures. to determine what happened and why during this evening's execution of Clayton Darrell Lockett.
Earlier today, hours before tonight's execution, death penalty opponents were at the state capitol and the governor's mansion asking Mary Fallon to stop tonight's proceedings. News Channel 4's Sarah Stewart joins us live from the capitol.
And Sarah, those opposed to the death penalty are pointing to tonight's incident in McAllister as more evidence against capital punishment.
Yeah, guys, they are, and they say they are appalled at tonight's events. The Oklahoma Coalition to Abolish the Death Penalty had a protest and vigil here today at the Capitol. As you said, they hosted a sit-in at Governor Fallon's office, followed by a vigil at the governor's mansion. And they say up until the very end, they were trying to talk to the governor to tell her, you're the only one who has the power now to stop this execution. We spoke with a member of that group this evening and asked her what she thought about tonight's execution. Here's what she had to say.
I was so appalled, I couldn't even talk. What? He suffered this cruel and unusual suffering for an hour? That's appalling. And I immediately think we have to halt all executions. We have to halt executions in Oklahoma.
Polly says she hopes tonight's execution shocks our legislators and the governor and that they thoroughly investigate. Of course, their group would ultimately like to see the death penalty abolished. Reporting live at the Capitol, I'm Sarah Stewart, News Channel 4.
Thank you, Sarah. So what will this mean legally for the state of Oklahoma? Joining us live from our newsroom is defense attorney Jackie Ford. And Jackie, as we heard, Lockett's attorney is contemplating a lawsuit against the state. What would the state's defense be? Is a blown vein common during executions?
I'm not sure we could say that there's anything that is common in executions. I think time will tell and a full investigation will be required to find out exactly what went on. It is my understanding that a blown vein could be based upon the person being dehydrated. In this case, Mr. Lockett refused his last meal. The Department of Corrections knew that. It was reported on earlier today. If he wasn't physically ready to endure the kind of treatment, if we're going to call it that, that was being given to him by the doctors, then certainly there's some liability there.
Jackie Ford will continue to follow the story. Thank you. Our coverage continues right now on KFOR.com. There you'll find extended interviews with several of the eyewitnesses who were in the death chamber tonight. Also see that a lot of people are weighing in with their own opinions of what happened during the execution.
Elsewhere tonight, an Oklahoma City man is fighting for his life tonight, while the female driver who allegedly hit him and, according to police, was driving drunk is already out of jail. And the victim's family is furious. The family of Clifford Park says he was hit while crossing the street near this intersection in Northwest 10th and Council. Police say the driver left the scene, leaving the injured man lying in the road. A witness followed the driver and called police. Authorities arrested 27-year-old Charity Slaughter at a nearby apartment complex. The victim's family says Parks has numerous injuries, including a shattered pelvis and internal bleeding. Slaughter is out on a $6,000 bond.
Bail or not, she shouldn't have been released, because if you do this once, you will do it again. I feel like she didn't care, because a person, a human being, you don't run over a human being and just keep going.
Investigators say the charges the suspect is facing right now are appropriate, but could change if the victim doesn't pull through.
Next in weather.
A three-day onslaught of severe weather, of course, including tornadic activity. A 130-plus tornadoes is starting to finally wind down tonight for our friends down in the southeast part of the U.S. Here in Oklahoma, it is brisk and it's still pretty breezy. How low those temperatures are going to go next.
Plus, a blockbuster development involving racist comments and a high-profile billionaire.
And grab your phone. Your chance to win $1,000 is coming up. You could have cash in your hands just like these Channel 4 viewers.
This is your cue to call or text. Text the word BANK to 45995 or call 877-642-5521. That's 877-642-5521.
Listen to your mother. It's good advice. It's also a female comedy show, and we've got free tickets to give away.
And school will be out soon. We're going to have some tips on helping your kids read over the summer.
And I'm tracking chilly temps changing over to hot temperatures. I'll let you know when, starting at 4.
Today, the hammer dropped on the billionaire owner of the Los Angeles Clippers basketball team.
The punishment comes just a few days after he was caught on tape saying unbelievably racist remarks.
NBC's Jennifer Borkland has tonight's update.
The controversy over racist comments made by Clippers owner Donald Sterling, less than a week old now, but to basketball fans looking forward to a playoffs game tonight, a seemingly long-awaited announcement from the NBA.
I am banning Mr. Sterling for life.
The ban means Sterling may not attend games, practices, or set foot in any Clippers facilities. He also may not attend Board of Governors meetings. Commissioner Adam Silver also imposing a $2.5 million fine and doing what he can to force the sale of the team.
The views expressed by Mr. Sterling are deeply offensive and harmful. That they came from an NBA owner only heightens the damage and my personal outrage.
Reaction from current and former players was swift and positive.
But I'm just thrilled with what Commissioner Silver did. He got on the case immediately. He got to the bottom of whatever mysteries there were involved in this and figured out what the truth was. And his actions and focus were so on the mark.
Commissioner Silver says Sterling has acknowledged that that is his voice on the recordings. The websites that posted the audio say Sterling was upset his girlfriend at the time, V. Stiviano, Instagrammed this photo with Magic Johnson.
You can do anything, but don't put him on an Instagram for the world has to see, so they have to call me. And don't bring him into my games, okay?
NBA insiders say forcing a sale is not that simple.
I think it's a slippery slope when you start trying to remove people from the NBA or any organization based off of their private thoughts that they have at home.
But now with the announcement that the NBA will try to force Sterling out answers that bigger question.
Whether or not these remarks were initially shared in private, they are now public and they represent his views.
And now we've heard from one of the owners of the Thunder responding to the controversy.
What he's saying about this whole mess coming up later in sports.
Tonight's Forewarn forecast is sponsored by Hudeberg Chevrolet. Now, weather with the Forewarn Storm Team's Mike Morgan.
This was tornado number 11 of a 135 tornado outbreak over the past 3 days in the United States. This, of course, is Quapaw, Oklahoma. It's the only tornado in our state in this outbreak, and this occurred about 5:30 Oklahoma time up in the far northeastern parts of our state. And this particular tornado is now rated a high-end EF2 to a very low-end EF3 tornado. Let's go ahead and take a look at the particulars of this particular tornado up in northeastern Oklahoma. One fatality, the result of this tornado. Four southwest of Quapaw, went through the west and north sides of Quapaw up there in northern Ottawa County, just south of the Kansas border, and then up to Baxter Springs, Kansas. It was just under 1/4 mile wide, and it was moving at about just under 50 miles per hour. Well, no severe weather in Oklahoma tonight, but it is brisk, isn't it? And the wind was up again today. That wind has been something else here lately. And skies across most of central Oklahoma are still mostly cloudy. Clouds act like a blanket, so we're not cooling down too much. We're 54 degrees right now with a north-northwest wind at 10 miles an hour. Barometer is rising rapidly. Our daytime high was 61. And our morning low temperature was 52, and we are really in very poor shape as far as precipitation. That by far is the biggest thing that we desperately need statewide. But it's dry. Skies are mostly cloudy outside right now. Temperatures are mostly in the low to a few mid 50s, and the winds are still breezy from the northwest, and the breeze will stay up tonight, so there's no risk of any frost or freezing temperatures for tonight. Absolutely none. We still have a mostly cloudy sky as well. Temperatures in northern Oklahoma are in the mid to upper 40s to near 50 right now, and down south we're in the lower to middle 50s, and the winds coming in still from the northwest. Pretty breezy still in western Oklahoma. Still some 30 mile per hour wind gusts. Earlier today in the panhandle, wind gusts of 60 miles per hour with widespread blowing dust across the panhandles and western Oklahoma earlier this afternoon. Crazy windy in that part of our state. Tonight, still a pretty good blanket of cloud cover. A couple of really light sprinkles that are just barely reaching the ground now coming into Harper and Woods counties up in the far northwestern parts of our state. All the result of this very powerful upper level low pressure area in Missouri right now. And the winds on the backside of that are driving down this chillier weather and those gusty northwesterly winds that will be with us tomorrow as well. I think down a notch or two, but it'll still be a windy day tomorrow. And even some rain, snow mixed in the Dakotas and Nebraska today. And here it is just a couple of days before May Day. Temperatures tonight, will be in the upper 30s in the north, about 40, maybe even 41 or 2 here in Oklahoma City for a low tonight. And the winds northwesterly at 10 to 18. Low 40s down south. Might see be a couple sprinkles in northern Oklahoma tonight. And for tomorrow, Wednesday, we'll have partly cloudy skies, a little more sun than we had today, but it'll be a windy day, a driving northwest wind once again at 20 to 35 miles per hour. Upper 50s to middle 60s for daytime highs. Will be a few degrees less chilly in the metro tomorrow, about 63 with a little bit more sunshine than what we had outside today. So still jacket weather. And then tomorrow night, we're talking about a little different scenario here as far as any frost is concerned. A bit less wind. Skies will be mostly clear. Temperatures will be a little bit chillier. So frost is possible just about any place in Oklahoma tomorrow night. And there should be at least a light freeze tomorrow night in the Panhandle, 37 tomorrow night right here in Oklahoma City. Now we're going to flip that coin to the other side and take a look at Sunday afternoon. These are the daytime highs. Forecasting 94 in Oklahoma City, and on Sunday, 100 degrees for a high in Woodward, and fire danger will be really quite high as we head toward Friday late into Saturday, Sunday, into Monday of next week. Look at those metro highs, mid-90s. I tell you, your pick day is Friday, not much wind, 40 for a low and 75 for a high. Next chance of storms, not a great opportunity, but about May the 8th. We got to watch that like a hawk, because that's the one thing that we really got to have is rain.
Yes, we do. Thanks, Mike. Well, who's going to win $1,000 in free cash?
Hope it's you. We're surprising tonight's winner next. Earlier in the newscast, we gave the cue to call, and now someone is just about to win $1,000 in cash.
Joining us on the phone is Sandra from Norman. Congratulations, my friend. You're $1,000 richer.
Are you kidding
me? No, we're not kidding.
Oh, my God.
What are you going to do with all that money?
Oh, pay some bills. Pay some bills.
Have you been trying very long to win?
This is my first time.
Here's luck. Well, congratulations to you. We're happy for you.
Thank you so much.
And for everyone else out there, you'll have your chance to win tomorrow night at 10.
Now sports with Brian Brinkley.
The Oklahoma City Thunder got even in their first round playoff series with Memphis with an overtime win in game 4 Saturday night. Tonight, OKC is back home looking to regain the series advantage. It has been a wild one. Memphis took a 20-point lead in the third quarter, and then OKC answered with a 22-4 run. They actually took the lead at 79-78, but Memphis on top now, 83-79. Winner takes a 3-2 series lead. We'll have a complete report from Bob Berry Jr. tomorrow morning. And you see the Thunder just scored. They're down 2 now. NBA Commissioner Adam Silver announced today the league is banning LA Clippers owner Donald Sterling for life, and he will have NBA owners vote to force Sterling to sell the team. Sterling made racist comments caught on audio tape that were made public over the weekend. This afternoon, the Thunder issued an official statement on the decision coming from Thunder Chairman Clay Bennett. The Oklahoma City Thunder strongly supports the decisive action taken today by NBA Commissioner Adam Silver. Ours is a league of inclusion, tolerance, and fairness. And Bennett went on to say the Thunder organization will continue to work to foster the tenets of diversity and respect and build on that standard moving forward. In the meantime, the LA Clippers playing tonight at home in Game 5 of their series against the Warriors. And before the game started, for the first time since Adam Silver announced the ban of Sterling, Doc Rivers, the LA Clippers head coach, talked to the media.
I felt the pressure on my players. You know, everyone was waiting for them to give a response. And, you know, I kept thinking, I mean, they didn't do anything, you know, yet they have to respond. And so Adam responded. And I thought that that was the sigh of relief.
And then a few hours later, about an hour later, the LA Clippers getting ready to play the Golden State Warriors, and the fans coming out in mass support of the LA Clippers, the coaches and the players. You see DeAndre Jordan coming in, Matt Barnes, and then former Sooner Blake Griffin coming into the arena. Lots of signs in support of the LA Clippers and anti-Donald Sterling, as you might imagine. Also, a lot of the sponsors that pulled their sponsorship from the Clippers had to have their signs covered up, because they're no longer officially sponsoring the Clippers. And right now, the Clippers leading the Warriors 31-20 early in the first half. Pete Hughes and the Oklahoma baseball team trying to break a losing streak. It didn't happen tonight against Dallas Baptist. Nash Knight with the double there to score 2. Dallas Baptist beat the Sooners 9-1. The Sooners have lost 6 in a row. OU with just 3 hits in the game. They'll host Baylor this weekend for a 3-game series at Mitchell Park. And the OU men's tennis team is the number 2 overall seed for the NCAA tournament. They will host first and second round matches matches in Norman next weekend. The OSU men's and women's teams also made the NCAA field. A final look at the 7-day forecast when we get back.
If you like brisk early spring weather, tomorrow and Thursday your days, and then a perfect day Friday, and then a lot of summertime coming.
Perfect day sounds good.
Have a good night.